so this talk will be in pseudo-Anosov flows in M3 closed. And actually, we're going to use the universal cover of M3. So let me define that. So I think Jonathan referred to Anosov yesterday. So if it has transversely hyperbolic behavior, meaning it has stable, denoted by this, and unstable, two-dimensional foliations, possibly singular. Singular can use in lots of different ways. So in a leaf of the stable foliation, so the stable foliation is saturated by the flow, and same thing for the unstable foliation. So orbits are forward asymptotic, and the unstable foliation, they are backwards asymptotic. So the picture is like this. So this is my orbit, and this would be the stable leaf through it, and this would be the unstable leaf through it. So contracting, say, in this direction, expanding in this direction. This is the non-singular. And singular is P prong type. So it's a P prong in the plane, locally P prong in the plane across an interval. So I'm going to draw here a three prong orbit. This is a singular orbit. I'm only, for purposes of a little bit of clarity, not to get too cluttered, I'm only going to draw the stable foliation. So there will be three sheets, three local sheets. All orbits are forward asymptotic. Right. And there are, all these orbits have to be closed, and finitely many. And the unstable foliation comes in sort of in between. Right. So extremely important for my definition is that P is always greater or equal than 3. So I'm not going to allow one prongs. There's also a theory with pseudo-Anosov with one prongs, but it's completely different from what I'm going to talk here. Right. And finally, if no singular orbits, then I'm going to call it Anosov. So I'm going to be interested in this flows in mainly hyperbolic manifolds and metric properties, so a relationship with the quasi-geodesic behavior. Okay? But first, let me give some examples. First, let's do suspension of pseudo-Anosov homeomorphous of surface Z. So you take the, say, the Fs and Fu, the stable and unstable one-dimensional foliations of the homeomorphism, and you suspend, and you get the two-dimensional stable and unstable foliations of the flow. So I'm actually pseudo-Anosov homeomorphism without one prongs. Okay, and here I am doing closed surface. Okay, so this is one of the classical examples. I guess viewpoint three manifolds are very comfortable and love this example. The second one, which is actually happened before this one, which is a primary one, is the geodesic flows geodesic flow of surface S of curvature less than zero. And if you prefer, you can think of constant curvature, so that's hyperbolic surface. So M is going to be the unit tangent bundle of S. And I have the geodesic flow. This is also actually Anosov. Anosov was the person who introduced this to study these flows, actually not just in surfaces, but in higher dimension where the curvature is less than zero, introduced all this technology. Okay. Right, so far, so the first example is hyperbolic, but we don't have examples of another flows hyperbolic. So then there's sort of more examples in hyperbolic and other stuff by then surgery. So Goodman did then surgery on an annulus transverse to, say, a suspension flow. What Jonathan said, have to be careful, and I'm not going to specify the careful here, to get examples of Anosov in hyperbolic, which was really surprising when this happened. This was in the late 70s. And then Freed generalized this, and he did something slightly different. So did surgery on closed orbits of pseudo-Anosov. So he blows up the orbit and then blows down differently. So blow up the orbit to a boundary T2, and then blows back along the surgery. So it turns out that there's a condition. So if the new so you open up the annulus, and then you sort of re-glue it in the along the dense surgery coordinates. In that case, it'll be a dense twist to get All right. So the condition is that new meridian intersects the collection of the, say, stable prongs. This is what Gabay called the degeneracy locus. In greater than 2 points, then the resulting flow is pseudo-Anosov. Right, without getting into details, the number of the intersection with the new meridian with the collection of stable prongs is that number, if it's n, is going to be the n prong of the resulting flow. So if it's greater than 2, you're going to have pseudo-Anosov. If you have 1, you're going to have a one prong flow. And if you have 0, you're going to actually have a stationary point. Okay? All right, so this is to say that pseudo-Anosov flows are extremely common. As you can see, then surgery is sort of one of the primary ways to get three manifolds. I'm going to look at the following question. So my goal here is to look at some of the flows in hyperbolic three manifolds. So when is the flow what's called quasi-geodesic? So so that meaning our flow lines quasi-geodesics. So quasi-geodesic when lifted to the universal cover, the embedding of flow line is a quasi-isometry. So flow length, so if I measure length along the flow line, and distance in M tilde are by Lipschitz related in the large. So for hyperbolic manifolds, so this is actually a general definition. So for M hyperbolic, this implies in particular that the flow line is a bounded distance from a geodesic. Okay, the bound, of course, depends on the by Lipschitz constants. Okay. So before talking about examples and the characterization, so on, let me mention that conversely. So here I'm going to talk about just pseudo-Anosov flows. So conversely, there's a theory of called general quasi-geodesic flows in M3 hyperbolic. So here I'm going to start with just a hyperbolic manifold. It's a quasi-geodesic flow. Does not have to be pseudo-Anosov, and there's lots of examples. So there's a whole theory that was started by Caligari and then greatly extended by Stephen Frankel, who's going to talk here on Thursday. And let me not talk anything more. All right. Okay. So so quasi-geodesic. So let's see. So in particular, Caligari proved, and there's lots of ways to do this, that quasi-geodesic implies uniform. I'm going to abbreviate this by QG. So the sort of the definition says, you know, that each individual line is a quasi-geodesic, but a priori the constants could be getting worse and worse. So Caligari shows this. Or for PA flows in hyperbolic manifolds, transitivity also implies that if it's quasi-geodesic, then it's uniform quasi-geodesic. Okay? All right, so let's see examples or counterexamples. So first of all, any suspension is quasi-geodesic. This actually is very general, has nothing to do with the fact that I'm serving the hyperbolic world. So so the case of suspension, so this is my flow here, whatever it is. If I take the cyclic cover, infinite cyclic cover, and I'm going to look at the flow here. And remember, I want to compare a distance along the flow lines with distance in the manifold. Okay? So here are the flow lines. So in this case, there's at, and these are the lifts of my fiber here, so z0, z1, z2, etc. So there is at least distance a0 between zi and zi plus 1. So you pay a certain distance to go across each level. And there is at most some flow distance a1 from zi to zi plus 1. So if you look at all the flow lines have to start here and go here. And because of compactness, there's the most flow distance this, and there you go. You get the by Lipschitz behavior. Okay, so notice I did not use hyperbolic here at all. Okay. Let's see. All right. So I guess the sort of the first naive question is, are there non-quasi-geodesic PA in M hyperbolic? I guess my feeling is that it's much harder to prove in general that, something is quasi-geodesic, but quasi-geodesic is a very strong property. Okay? But it turns out that it's not entirely obvious how to get examples which are non-quasi-geodesic. And the answer is yes, even for Anosov. Okay, so so there are many examples. The Anosov. And now I'm going to introduce one technical term here, are covered in M hyperbolic none of these are hyperbolic. So okay, so let me just say what is our cover. So this is Anosov. Oh yes, thank you. Right, so what is our cover? So our cover means that the stable foliation, for example, turns out that you can do the unstable foliation as well. So when you lift to the universal cover, and the tilde is going to refer to objects universal cover, this is a two-dimensional foliation universal cover. This has a leaf space homeomorphic to the real line, OK? Which is not always true. There are lots of examples where this is not true. And the examples are for particular, if I do then surgery on suspensions, I have to be careful. Cannot do any then surgery. Also, even more careful in geodesic flows with some care. I'm not going to describe that. Right, so let me explain. I'm going to talk a little bit why these are not quasi-geodesic. Because that will involve sort of the main property that's going to be sort of related to this quasi-geodesic behavior. So let's assume that I'm in this situation. I have R covered in hyperbolic. I covered Anosov. Okay, so why not quasi-geodesic? Okay. So there's a property that they satisfied, which is the following. For these flows, any closed orbit gamma of the flow is freely homotopic to infinitely many other closed orbits. Okay, I'm not gonna get into why this is true because that involves understanding that sort of the structure of the R cover and other flows, which I don't want to get into here. I can talk to you later if you want. Well, it turns out that implies that the unstable is also R covered, and it turns out that they have to have a sort of a global structure in universal cover. I'm going to get into that a little bit later on. Yes, and that case is actually very restrictive. Okay, so let's take this property as a given, and this property is the one that's going to imply not quasi-geodesic behavior. So why? So let's assume suppose that this flow is quasi-geodesic and I want to draw a contradiction. Right, so then it's uniform, quasi-geodesic. So let a gamma orbit and gamma I freely homotopic to gamma. And this were all going to be associated with G, an element of the fundamental group. I'm going to leave to the universal cover, which will turn out to be a sort of a central object for this question. And I'm going to see what's happening. So they all have, they're freely homotopic. They all have same sort of ideal points. So they are a bounded distance from each other, fixed because they're all the same quasi-geodesic for the same k. So in particular, I'm just going to get one property that will turn out to be a contradiction. There are gamma I, gamma j distinct, but so that they are very close, so that the stable of one intersects the unstable of the other one. Okay, so what I see in the universal cover, this is my gamma I tilde, this is my gamma j tilde. This is unstable direction, this is stable direction. This is what's going to be a contradiction. Okay, so here's, to sort of help us to understand this better, see, we have this universal cover, it has this flow. It turns out that the flow is actually very well behaved in universal cover. So this is a general property. For any pseudo-Anosov flow, M hyperbolic not needed. Then what I call the orbit space, and this is the orbit space of the flow in universal cover. So this is sort of, you should think this locally two-dimensional, but it turns out that this is really very nice. This is homeomorphic to R2. Okay. In particular, and also because you know the stable and stable foliations are sort of saturated by the flow, then this induce one-dimensional, sort of possibly singular foliations. In this orbit space. Okay. Later on, I'm going to talk in more detail about the suspension case of pseudo-Anosov homeomorphism, which you actually can see much better when I get into some more technical stuff. Okay. Right. So, and then they are sort of transverse to each other. Okay. So, in particular, a leaf, the one, say the stable intersects a leaf of the other one in less than one point. So it may not intersect, but it cannot intersect in 2 points just because of properties of transverse foliations in the plane, even with singularities. Okay. So I'm going to look at this situation in the orbit space. So in the orbit space, so this is going to be a point pi, and the other one is going to be a point pj. And I'm going to have the pi here, the stable, and the pj here, and the unstable. Okay. And they intersect in only one point. Okay. So I know that, just remember, G is the covering translation associated with this orbits. I know that the G of Pi is equal to Pi. G of Pj is equal to Pj. And because the intersection is unique, this point here, G of P is equal to P. So that means that this orbit here associated to this is actually projected to a closed orbit. So now go back in M. I'm going to have, say, the stable leaf of gamma I. And there's the gamma I here. And there's another closed orbit. Okay? Because this is preserved by G, and this is preserved by G. So this is a contradiction, because all orbits in a leaf of the stable foliation are asymptotic. So you can have at most one closed orbit. Okay? And the contradiction was that, you know, if you have too many orbits which are nearby in universal curve, which are associated with the same covering translation, they have to intersect this way. Okay? All right. So this shows that there's lots of things which are not quasi-geodesic. Let me emphasize this here. Right. So the orbit space is two-dimensional, is R2. Also, obviously, the fundamental group X in this orbit space. And this is the nice thing is that this is two-dimensional. So it's much easier to understand than the three-dimensional stuff. Okay. All right. Let me give some other all right. So I gave one example where it's quasi-geodesic suspension. I gave sort of a large class of examples where it's not quasi-geodesic. Let me give them some other examples here. So if a flow is almost transverse to a finite depth foliation, which was introduced by Gabay. So this is a technical term. You know, it has to do something to the flow. So think transverse. So think of a flow transverse to a finite depth foliation in M3 hyperbolic. Then the flow is quasi-geodesic. And this exists whenever, you know, second first homology has is infinite. Okay? So let me.
P is also assumed to be pseudo-Anosov here, though.
What?
P is assumed to be pseudo-Anosov.
Oh, yes, yes, yes. Yes, thank you. Right. So for the rest of the talk, it's always going to be pseudo-Anosov, even if I forget. All right. Thank you. All right. So let me just say one idea here. So there's a whole history of working with hierarchies and what the foliation is, et cetera, et cetera. So let me just look at one case. Suppose the compact leaves are not fibers or virtual fibers, because that essentially falls into the case of the suspension. Even though the foliation doesn't have to be a suspension, it can perturb it to be finite depth. Okay, let's suppose that this is the case. I don't have that. Then compact leaf is quasi-Fuchsian. So this is the big result of Thurston Bonahan, which implies that, let's call compact leaf, let's call this S. So any lift S tilde is a quasi disk. The limit set in the sphere at infinity is a quasi circle, blah, blah, blah. Okay. So, So I'm just going to give one idea here. So suppose an orbit of the flow keeps intersecting compact leaves. So then lift to the inverse of cover. I'm going to have H3. So here is a lift S tilde, and my orbit intersects this, and then keeps intersecting. And the thing, because they're quasi-Fuchsian and it keeps intersecting, they have to shrink to a point. Okay. So then the orbits have unique ideal points. And you can start getting a lot of information from that. Okay? Obviously, this is way more complicated than that, but that's sort of the genesis. So what did I do here? So I use a geometry of my foliation to get information about the flow. So it turns out this is one method to prove that the flows are quasi-geodesic. And the same thing was happened for suspension. Let me mention one other case, and then I'll talk about what happens in general. So another example. So if P is transverse to a slithering foliation F, and regulating, I'm going to say what regulating is, then I guess pseudo-Anosov. Yes, and also in M hyperbolic. Right, I actually don't need hyperbolic for this, but you know, that's what we're interested in. Then this flow is quasi-geodesic. Okay, so what does a slithering is essentially like uniform, meaning any two leaves in the universal curve, when you leave to the foliation of the universal curve, that any two leaves are bounded Hausdorff distance from each other. Obviously, the bound depends on the particular collection of leaves. So think suspension or a vibration over the circle. So the leaves of the fibers, you know, are bounded distance from each other, and all the leaves in between satisfy that too. Okay. Regulating means that each flow line of the lifted flow intersects every leaf of the lifted foliation. So there's sort of a intersection-wise a product picture. This type of foliation was introduced or analyzed by Thurston in the 90s. And the idea for quasi-geodesic is similar to suspension. So if you sort of go far enough out from the leaves, you have to pay a certain distance to go from one leaf to the other, and at most a certain flow distance. So it's very much like suspension. So I really don't need hyperbolic for that. Okay? All right, now I'm ready to state sort of the general characterization of pseudo-Anosov flows, which is actually going to be sort of very different from this. So see, this is examples. They all use a foliation, okay, to get information about the flow. Well, slitherings, yes. There's lots of slitherings, actually very common. So here, there's lots of finite depth foliations. Oh, yes. Yes, so yes. Yes. Well, so yes. I'm not quoting everything. So you use results of Gebye and Mosher to show that there is a pseudo-Anosov which is almost transversal foliation. Yes. Thank you. Yeah. All right. Okay. So let me state the theorem. So start with a pseudo-Anosov flowing closed hyperbolic manifold. Then the flow is quasi-geodesic if and only if, so it's a completely characterizing condition. Yes. So there is n zero natural numbers, which is going to be fixed. So that for any closed orbit gamma of the flow, so this is going to be a condition on freely homotopic orbits. It is freely homotopic to at most n zero other closed orbits. Okay. Right. So just to mention a couple of things. Obviously, the examples that I gave, which are not quasi-geodesic, they failed this because every closed orbit is freely homotopic to infinitely many other orbits. The suspension, in particular, the suspension, there are no free homotopies for those flows which are, and also in the case where it's transverse to a slithering, there's no, also, no free homotopies. And in that case where it's transverse to a finite foliation, it's not clear. But this theorem says that there can only be finitely many. All right, so okay. So let me talk a little bit about some ideas on how to do this. This is sort of very long, so I'm not obviously not going to have time to. I think that probably doesn't happen, but that's the next project. All right. So I'm not assuming that there's any foliation here, so I'm not going to use foliations to two-dimensional foliations to get information here. So let's see. Right, so I'm going to break it down. So first of all, this is follows from, if it's quasi-geodesic, and then there's upper bound n0, so follows from the previous argument. Because if it's quasi-geodesic, then it's uniformly quasi-geodesic. So then the all the orbits have to be a fixed bounded distance from the corresponding geodesic. And that our argument, once you fix the flow, and you have too many which are a bounded distance from each other, you're going to have stable and unstable intersecting. So that gives that argument gives that. The other direction, of course, is the non-trivial direction, which is very complicated. So so we're going to break down. I'm going to do it in two steps. So first is so use the pseudo-Anosov dynamics, which is the only thing that we have. From that, we're going to get ideal information about the universal curver. And from that, I'm going to get information about pi 1 of m. I'm going to explain what I mean by this and comp- projectification of the universal cover. You think, wait a minute, but it's hyperbolic. Actually, this is going to be in sort of a different setup. And finally, I'm going to get this is quasi-geodesic. All right, so let me we're going to sort of change the assumptions a little bit. In other words, we're going to prove something which is maybe a little more general. So on M known assumption. So I'm not going to assume anything about M, but I'm going to assume things about on the flow. So this set have cardinality less than or equal to n0, and also no non-trivial free homotopy from a closed orbit to itself. Okay. So first of all, this sort of the second thing is actually very common. If you start with the geodesic flow, any closed orbit, which is a closed geodesic, you know, when you look at the geodesic flow in that unit tangent bundle, it's freely homotopic to itself. You just go turn around the angle by 2 pi. So all this is all I'm going to assume. Actually, this is going to imply stuff about the M and so on. Okay. All right. So now we're going to have several steps. So first step is there is a compactification of the orbit space O with ideal circle, and the union is this, a closed disk. What do I want to say here? Right, using only what I have, the stable and unstable foliations, and pi 1 of m acts naturally on this compactification. Okay, so this first step, which I hope to talk a little bit later, this is true for any pseudo-Anosov flow, okay, even without these assumptions. So this is always true. Okay, so there'll be 6 steps. All right. So from the second step on, now I'm going to assume the assumptions that I have. Right, I forgot to say something. So if you have this, if you have a non-trivial free homotopy from a closed orbit to itself, this generates a Z2 in the fundamental group of M. So obviously an obstruction to M being hyperbolic. So I don't want that. Right, so the second, now under these assumptions, construct R, which is going to be a quotient. This is an equivalence relation. Which is going to be the flow ideal boundary of the universal cover. Okay. Think Cannon Thurston maps, okay, which perhaps will become clearer later on. Okay. Third step, and this is the main step, And this is where all the work goes in. Right, oh yeah, so in pi 1 of m, x on this flow ideal boundary. Third step is to show that pi norm 1 acts as a uniform convergence group on this flow ideal boundary. We're going to use only the stable and stable foliations and the pseudo-Anosov flow dynamics. Okay. At the end of the talk, I hope to say what do I mean by uniform convergence group. All right, so fourth step is use a theorem of Bowditch, which is a sort of weak hyperbolization theorem. If you have this, it turns out that this space R has certain properties. It turns out we're going to be homomorphic to S2, and the action is going to be have nice properties as well. So to show that pi 1 of m is Gromov hyperbolic, and then of course by the geometric conjecture is going to be hyperbolic, okay? What do I want? And the R is pi 1 of m equivariantly homeomorphic to the boundary of this, which is a sphere. Okay, the Gromov boundary of the group, which is a sphere. Okay, so in other words, what I'm doing here is that using the flow, I do this ideal circle for the orbit space, whatever that is. I get this quotient, which is a sphere, and later on we'll see that it makes sense that it is the flow ideal boundary. And I have a group action there. Well, it turns out that it has this property, and from that property, it says that what I did was actually the same thing as the Gromov compactification. So we're using this result, which is crucial here. Okay, so that's happening. That's what's happening in the sort of the boundary. But I actually want to get information in the manifold. So that will be the fifth step. Okay, so using this, there is a flow compactification, which is universal curver for this, and there's a topology. And using Gromov, the Bowditch result and some other stuff, so this is equivariantly homeomorphic to the Gromov compactification. So now sixth and final step. So the flow behaves well in the flow compactification, hopefully, right? So this implies that it behaves well in the Gromov compactification, and that is what's going to give us the quasi-geodesic behavior. So I'm going to say a little more about this step, and I'm going to talk a little more about some of the other steps. Okay, so what do I mean by behaves well? Okay, so in this compactification, and then it turns out it's going to have the same thing in the other compactification. So there are three properties. The first property, so every flow line gamma has unique. So the gamma is contained in the universal curver. And then it's properly embedded. Okay, so it can accumulate. So when we go forward, it can only accumulate rotating points in the boundary. So has unique forward ideal points, gamma plus, and backwards, gamma minus. So this is behaves sort of like a quasi-geodesic in H3. Okay. Second thing is that for every gamma, the forward ideal point and the backward ideal points in this flow configuration are distinct, just like for a quasi-geodesic. And the third property is that the plus map is continuous, and the minus map is continuous, which is the same if you have a flow by uniform quasi-geodesic. So, okay. So this is always true also in the Gromov complexification. So this implies that the same three properties true in the Gromov complexification. And this, by result of myself and Lee Mosher, it's not hard, implies that the flow is quasi-geodesic. Okay, so that's it. Right, so now let me talk, I don't have much time, so let me talk about the first step. Right, so the first step is this, a compactification of the orbit space. Maybe I'll talk a little bit about step two. Okay, so. Yes, yes, yes. So, or you can think of an alternative way of getting that. Okay, all right. Okay, so let's see. Step one, O, orbit space. So, what is. Well, actually, there are a lot of ways of compactifying the orbit space, a lot of ways which, you know, we define the group X naturally. This is one way. All right, so recall an example. So I'm going to do an explicit example that a lot of people here, maybe everybody here is familiar. Suppose this is suspension of a pseudo-Anosov of Z. Okay. So then, fix Z tilde a lift to the universal cover. So because it's suspension, every orbit of the flow intersects this Z tilde, and only once. Okay. So in particular, this implies that the orbit space is naturally identified with this lift of the fiber. Okay. And the sort of what I call the stable and unstable foliations are the same as the lifts of stable and unstable foliations off the homeomorphous to Z. Okay? And Z obviously is like H2. Okay? All right, so here's my orbit space, which is Z tilde of H2, and there has the stable and, say, the unstable. Okay. So this is like the OS, this is OU. Okay. Now, obviously, the Z tilde has a computation as H2, so it has a computation with the circle and infinity. Okay. But I'm not allowed to use that. I'm only allowed to use this foliations here. Okay, so think an ideal point. So what happens is that it's going to have a neighborhood system defined by either stable leaves or unstable leaves, and a lot of times, for most of them, both of them. So each a sequence of stable or unstable, and most of the time both, leaves which are nested and escape. Any collection of nested leaves which escape, because in hyperbolic structure they are uniform quasi-geodesics, and if they escape, they are going to converge to an ideal point. Okay, well, that's how I want to define. Now, notice if P in my ideal boundary is ideal point of unstable, say this point here, then I cannot use unstable leaves. I have to use sort of stable leaves, and it will be stable leaves that intersect this unstable leaf. So use stable leaves intersecting this unstable. Okay. So I would like to do the same thing in general. Okay. Can we do this in general? So sort of, because you're always going to have this picture. Can we just say that an ideal point is such? So it's like it's going to be equivalence class. It's equivalence class of this escaping leaves, either stable or unstable. Well, it turns out that is no. And it turns out, so you don't see this in this case, and you don't see in the case also the transverse to slitherings, because there's something there too. And it's exactly because of the freely homotopic orbits. Okay, so I guess I'm just going to do this in the last 5 minutes. This is going to be a little more technical, so, but it will just give you an idea of what sort of the free homotopic orbits do. Okay, so suppose there are freely homotopic orbits beta and gamma. So lift coherently to the universal cover. And so it turns out that they have to be, so I mean, think of the orbit space in O, they are connected. This is the technical objects by a chain of lozenges. Okay, so this is sort of one technical object. So here is one, and here is the other one. I'm going to do the simplest picture, just because it's sort of running out of time. And this is going to be a chain of things like this. And each one of this is a lozenge. So these are actual points in the my orbit space. These are sort of ideal points. So sort of formally, it's like a rectangle. It's like a generalized rectangle. So in O, a lozenge is a proper embedding of a rectangle, but I'm going to remove two corners, 1, 0, and 0, 1, so that horizontal goes to stable, and the vertical goes to unstable, okay? So I have this. There are two actual corners, and then there's two ideal corners. So say this horizontal, these are stable. These are unstable, okay? Anyway, you always have this. This corner that's missing is what I call the missing corner. Is a what I call a perfect fit. So suppose that this is stable, this is unstable. So it's like these two leaves are asymptotic, sort of like asymptotic. Okay, so they don't intersect, but they almost intersect. So if I move this leaf a little bit this way, I get this. If I move this leaf a little bit this way, I sort of get intersection. Okay, all right. Okay, so and just to finish, so this the perfect fits are actually the corners, the problems here. With this idea here, okay. So suppose that I have a ray in the unstable foliation. Suppose that this makes a perfect fit with the stable leaf. Okay. So to define the ideal point here, what would I do? Well, I would get sort of the stable leaves. I guess I erased that picture. So I guess the stable leaves which intersect this, and hope that they escape in the orb space. Okay, this sequence does not escape. So that's the problem. And because of that, one needs to generalize, use not just leaves, but what I call polygonal paths. Yes. Let me stop here. It's a good breaking point. Thank you.